Well, God bless you and welcome to Wow Worship and Word on Wednesday. Of course, I am super excited about what the Lord is doing in this series on the blueprint for success. God wants your life to be a grand success. He wants everything that you do, every assignment that he's placed you on, he wants you to be a great success in it. He told you in Psalms 1, that you're going to be like a tree that's planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth fruit in its season, and whatsoever you doeth, it shall prosper. And I came to tell you that you've got to embrace that. I've been teaching on this for the last 2-3 months, and you got to embrace this concerning God's will for your life. I'm coming to you on a kind of different setting here, different scene, had a whole lot going on today. And so here we are. I'm so glad about it. Now, this is what I need you to do. You know what I'm about to say. I need you to hit that share button, down to the bottom of your screen on the left. Hit that share button and include this message, this teaching with someone on your page. Make sure that this message goes out, because someone needs to be blessed in this season and know that God has called them to be a success. If you're on YouTube, I need you to hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, and subscribe to our YouTube page. It's going to be an absolute blessing to you. You'll get a notification every time we're on the air, and it's going to bless your life. Well, let's pray. Father, we thank you and we glorify you. We honor you for this opportunity and for this wonderful privilege. It's in the name of Jesus that we come, and we ask you, Father, that you would be the master teacher on this afternoon. Have your way in us and through us. Speak through these lips of clay and give someone listening ears that they might hear and become a doer of your word. And we do give you praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, we've been talking about the blueprint for success, and tonight we're picking it up and finishing where we left on last Wednesday night. We talked from the subject, the land is yours, but you got to show up. The land is yours, but you have to show up. And we look at Joshua chapter 1 and verse number 3. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that you walk on, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. And then he talks about from the wilderness Lebanon, even to the great river, the river Euphrates, and the land of the Hittites, and the land of the Jebusites, and all those other Ites and Tites. He says, I've given you the land, but there's something you got to do. You got to get out and walk on it. In other words, I've caused you, amen, to take possession of the land. Amen. In the spirit, but in the natural, you got to go out there and possess it. That word possess means occupy. You got to occupy it. You got to go there and take it. You got to claim it. And I believe that's what the Lord, so often, I want you to hang with me for a minute. I'm going to finish up last week. And what you may need to do is go back later on, look at last week, and then look at this week and mash it together, and you'll see where we are. So many times we get the prophetic. All right. But then we don't add the principle to the prophetic that brings forth manifestation. Let me say it again. So often we get the prophetic and we get excited. Oh, the land is yours. Hallelujah. But we don't add the principle to the prophetic, which brings the promise, the manifestation. And you got to do that. Somebody put that in the chat box. You got to add the principle to the prophetic to get the promise. Somebody put it there. Again, you got to add the principle to the prophetic to get the promise. Let me say it again. You got to add the principle to the prophetic to get the promise. The prophetic is the spoken word, or the red word, the logos, or the rhema. The rhema, the embedded word that lets you know what God is going to do. But then God always adds conditions to his promises. Amen. That's the principle. How do I walk it out? What are my steps? What do I have to do? God is always going to do his part, but what do I have to do to make sure that what God has promised me come to pass? That's the principle. And once I take my part and match it with his promise and match it with the prophetic, then I end up with, amen, the manifestation. And so the Lord told Joshua, look, you got to go. And I talked about it all last week, how they sent the spies out. Talked about how 10 of the spies, these good men, the mighty men, 10 of the spies came out, you know, and came back with negative reports. But Joshua and Caleb, they came back and said, we are well able. God is with us. And we're well able to take the land. But they did not go into the land of promise because of the negative report of 10 spies, 10 leaders that looked at the sons of Anak and looked at the giants of the land, the Nephthims of the land, and would not possess the land because of their fear. And on tonight, we want to look at Numbers chapter 14. We want to finish this. The land is yours, but you got to show up. You got to show up. Listen, the house is yours, but you got to show up. You got to do your part. Praise God. Good health is yours. All of that's a part of good success. Good health is a part of good success. It's yours, but you got to what? Show up. Amen. Glory to God. Whatever God has spoken to your life, it is yours, but you have got to do your part and show up. So Numbers chapter 14, praise God. Now watch this. Number one, if we look at Numbers chapter 14, we're beginning at verse number one. The first principle I want to show you from Numbers 14, because this is going to be all inclusive now. This is the close of this thing. Is that they act like crybabies. Now listen to what it says. And all the congregation lifted up their voice and cried, and the people wept that night. This is the result of these spies going out, and they spying the land of 12 spies, two good reports, 10 bad reports, and they decide they can't take the land. And so now this is the after effects. This is what happens after that. So watch what happened. Number one, they act like crybabies. They went back to the village, they started crying and weeping, and the Bible says they wept that night, which means all night long they wept about the promise that they would not possess. Listen, crying about it is not going to help. I'm telling you right now, people shed tears, and I've been in this thing for a long time. I watch people shed tears with no kind of mindset to go out there and actually do the hard work. And 10 years later, they're shedding tears. They shed tears saying, oh God, I know you're going to do it. I know you're going to do it. And they're not going to do the work. Some shed tears. Oh, I'm going to change one day. They're not going to do the work. Your tears. Listen, I thank God for the fact that the Bible says that God takes our tears and he put them in a jar, and our tears remind him of us and all of that. And that's absolutely true. God is mindful of your tears. Praise God. But faith moves God, and faith is action. You got to put it to action. Remember, the problem with the children of Israel was they heard the word of God, but they did not mix the word of God with faith. Faith is the principle of this. It's action. It's moving. What you say, God, I'm going to what? Do. I'm not going to cry about it. I'm going to do. Now watch verse number two. Watch what happens now. Number two. And all the children of Israel murmured against Moses. So they cried. Now they're murmuring against leadership. They did what? They blamed leadership. Watch us say, all the congregation murmured against Moses, against Aaron, and the whole congregation have said unto them, would God that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would God we had died in this wilderness? Wherefore hath the Lord, verse 3, brought us into this land to fall by the sword, that our wives and our children should be prey? Were it not better for us to return into Egypt? And they said one to another, let us make a captain and let us return into Egypt. Now watch this. Not only are they blaming Moses, but they said, let's look amongst ourselves, make us a captive, and let's go back to Egypt. Listen, every time you blame leadership for your faults, you will always go back into captivity. There's no problem with the word. There's no problem with the one who sows the word. There's no problem with God. The problem is always the ground. Let me say it again. The problem is always the ground. You remember the word of God was spread by the sower. Some fell on good ground. Some fell on stony ground. Some fell on thorny ground. Some fell by the wayside. This is those who would hear the word of God. The sower is just giving you what? Amen. The seed maker, praise God, or the seed producer is saying. Amen. All Moses was a vessel that God was using to deliver his people from out of Egypt. Praise God. But the people blamed Moses. There are a lot of people that play the blame game. This is why I'm not. No, you are why you are such and such and such a place. Now watch this. God will deal with you, praise God, in grace for the hesitations and the hindrances and the things that were initially your problem. What was the initial problem with Israel? They were in Egyptian bondage. What did God do? He dealt with that. He sent them a deliverer. But here's the problem. You can't only come out of a situation. You've got to always be going into something also. You can't stay in the middle place. There's so many people that have come out of sin, come out of what the enemy had done to them, and beautifully surrendered their life to the Lord. But they never went into whatever God had purpose and plan for their lives. And so while they're in this middle place, they blame everybody. Oh, you know, the reason why I'm stuck here is because of what so-and-so did to me. No, if you are a believer, hear what I'm saying. Now, if you believe the Lord Jesus Christ, you've been born again. You've tasted of the Spirit of God. Praise God. And God have brought you out of circumstances and situations that held you hostage and held you bondage. Your lack of faith to follow hard after God into your promised land is your problem. Not your leader. Not your man of God. Not your woman of God. For a matter of fact, amen, they should have been celebrating Moses. Moses brought them out after 430 years of captivity. Come on now, that's something to celebrate. But so often, people forget about where they've been brought out of when they get in a tight spot and they start blaming leadership. Now watch this. Verse 5. Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before all the assembly of the congregation of the children of the Lord. And so watch this. Moses began to preach another encouraging sermon after he heard from the Lord. Verse 6, and Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, which were of them that searched the land, rent their clothes, and they spake unto all the company of the children of Israel, saying, the land which we possess through to search it is an exceeding good land, and the Lord delight in us. So watch this now. Joshua and Caleb is preaching this message. He says, the land is a good land. Amen. Moses and Aaron, they're fasting and praying. Joshua and Caleb is preaching to them another message. Then verse 8 says, if the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which floweth with milk and honey. Well, guess what? They knew God delighted in them because God had delivered them. They knew that they were the children of God because God sent Moses to them and told Moses what to preach. Amen. And here it is. Aaron is reminding them. Joshua is reminding them of what they already know. But watch what he says now. Verse 9, only rebel not against the Lord, neither fear ye the people of the land, for they are bread for us. They are bread for us. Their defense is departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Fear them not. Glory to God. What a message. What a message. I can hear the hammering in the background. Fear them not. Praise God. They get another sermon. Get up from the crying. Get up from the pity party. Get up from all of that. It's time to move forward, and God is for us and with us. All right, here we go now. Watch the congregation response to this word. Praise the Lord. Watch this now. Verse 10. But all the congregation bade stone them with stones. And the glory of the Lord appeared in the tabernacle of the congregation before all the children of Israel. This is their response. Stone. After a great message. These people are religious now. These people are religious. These folks say they know God, but they don't really know God. They're trying to stone the messenger. Praise God. They're trying to kill the one that is giving them the bread of life to take them into their promised land. Man, what a way to kill your blessings. What a way to destroy, amen, the prosperity, amen, the success that God would place on your life. They go after trivial things. They go after the leader. Some folk, watch this. Some folk would rather be analytical than always analyze somebody else instead of take the opposition in front of them. Take it by force and move into their prophetic place. Let me say it again. God wants you to take the opposition in front of you by force and move forward into your prophetic place. Regardless. But you can't do it with the blame game. Now watch the Lord's response. Number 5, the Lord's response. Verse 11. Y'all got it? I'm in Numbers chapter 14. And the Lord said unto Moses, how long will this people provoke me? How long will it be in their belief towards me? For all the signs which I showed among them, I will smite them with pestilence and disinherit them and will make of thee a great nation and mightier than they. Now watch this. God said they're murmuring against leadership. They're murmuring against me. You've already saw that they 10 times they tested God. God said, I'll tell you what, I'm going to disinherit them. My God. Hallelujah. And God says, I done showed them signs and wonders and miracles. They still don't believe. So I'm going to disinherit them. And I'm going to smite them with pestilence. And then I'm going to take you, Moses, the leader. My God. I'm going to take you, the leader, and raise a great nation up from you that's mightier than them. Woo, man, look at God. Praise God. Amen. I got a word for somebody. You better be careful how you talk about leadership. You better be careful of your disdain for leadership. You better be careful when you talk about people that God have anointed. He said, touch not mine anointed and do my prophet no harm. You know, a great leader don't go and try to, you know, rail accusation for accusation and get back at people. Praise God. A great leader just sits back and let God handle it all. Praise the Lord. Now watch Moses. Watch the greatness of Moses. Praise God. Verse 13. And Moses said unto the Lord, if you do this thing, if you disinherit them and you kill them all through pestilence and problems and disease, watch Moses. Moses' love for the people. Moses said to the Lord, then the Egyptians shall hear it, for thou broughtest this people in thy light from among them, and they will tell it to the inhabitants of this land, for they have heard that the Lord art among this people, that thou, the Lord, have seen face to face, and that thy cloud standeth over them, and that thou goest before them by daytime in the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire by night. Verse 15, now if thou shalt kill all this people as one man, then the nation which have heard the fame of thee will speak and say, because the Lord was not able to bring them into this land, therefore he have slain them in the wilderness. And now I beseech thee, let the power of my Lord be great, according as thou hast spoken, saying, the Lord is long-suffering, great of mercy, forgiving iniquity and transgression, and by no man means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third or fourth generation. Pardon, I beseech thee, the iniquity of your people according to your great mercy, as thou hast forgiven this people from Egypt even unto now. Man, this is the epitome of good leadership. Moses, I don't care what you say about me, the purpose is more important than the person. Woo, let me say it again. Moses said, he didn't put that in comment box. Moses said, I don't care anything about what you all have said about me. The purpose is more important than the person. And he begs God, don't kill them. If you kill them, these Egyptians gonna tell the inhabitants of the land, God brought y'all out of Egypt, did some great things, but could not take you into the promised land. And watch what God says. Number 7, God's judgment. And the Lord said, I pardon according to thy word. But as truly as I live, all the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord. Because of those men which have seen my glory and my miracles, which I did in Egypt and in the wilderness, and have tempted me now these 10 times, and have not hearkened unto my voice, surely they shall not see the land which I swore to their fathers, neither shall any of them that provoke me. Praise God. And then verse 29. Your carcass shall fall in the wilderness, and all that were numbered of you according to the whole number, from 20 years old and upward, which have murmured against me. So we asked the question earlier in this lesson. Why were they not successful? Why wasn't the children of Israel successful in inheriting the promise of God? Here it is. Simply unbelief, murmur against God and leadership, tempting and testing God, not applying the word of God. They heard the word, but they didn't apply it. Here I am, I'm closing. I want to say to somebody this afternoon, you can hear all this word and still not be successful. Still miss God's plan for your life. Still miss God's purpose for your life. All because you allow doubt and unbelief to fill you, to fill your mind. The enemy speaking to your heart against your leader, against everybody around you to make you think that they are the culprit to why you've not walked into your promised possession. I want to suggest to you, the land is yours, but you got to possess it. You got to take that word that's being preached to you, apply that word to your life, and then watch God turn around and show you manifestation. We live in a time now where people don't believe that the word works. The word works if you work the word. This is the teaching for tonight. I hope somebody's been blessed. I hope that I've been able to convey it in such a simple matter that you just did not miss it. I want to say to you, God bless you. Listen, if this ministry has been a blessing to you, is being a blessing to you, would you consider sowing into the work of the Lord? I'm here to tell you the work is certainly being blessed. We've been blessed. We're not just the kind of church to take in. We give a lot out. We give a lot away. For a matter of fact, right now, we're right in the middle of another rent and mortgage assistance program. We have a rent and mortgage for about 40 families. Praise God. Don't forget, if you have someone you know that have been affected by COVID, that's going through a hard time and they need rent and mortgage assistance, let them know that they can contact our team at N-A-L Varnville. N-A-L Varnville at gmail.com. And our team will send them out an application to be considered for this rent and mortgage relief program. Amen. Our Joseph Storehouse, man, we are trying to meet the needs of Hampton County. Every Thursday morning from 9 until 11 a.m., we are there giving away food and commodity items to be a blessing to our community. If you want to partner with this ministry, praise God, and be a blessing to this Hampton County community and surrounding areas. There's going to be some giving platforms on the screen right after this message on tonight. Send a seed. Let God bless you. Amen. For your blessing to the kingdom work of God here at New Abundant Life Church. God bless you is our prayer. I want to say join us for Mother's Day service on our e-church platform, Sunday morning, 9 a.m. And then join us in person at 10 a.m. there at 115 Foster Street, Bonneville, South Carolina, for our Sunday morning worship alive, honoring mothers. God bless you as I pray. Stay tuned for, amen, the platforms that you can give to. We love you in Jesus' name. Peace.